Good morning. Now Jethro, the priest of Midian and father-in-law of Moses, heard of everything God had done for Moses and for his people Israel, and how the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt. Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, together with Moses' sons and wife, came to him in the wilderness where he was camped near the mountain of God. So Moses went out to meet his father-in-law and bowed down and kissed him. They greeted each other, and then they went into the tent. And Moses told his father-in-law about everything the Lord had done to Pharaoh and the Egyptians for Israel's sake, and about all the hardships they had met along the way, and how the Lord had saved them. Jethro was delighted to hear about all the good things the Lord had done for Israel in rescuing them from the hand of the Egyptians. He said, "Praise be to the Lord who rescued you from the hand of the Egyptians and of Pharaoh, and who rescued the people from the hand of the Egyptians." The next day, Moses took his seat to serve as judge for the people. They stood around him from morning till evening. And when his father-in-law saw all that Moses was doing for the people, he said, "What is this that you are doing for the people? Why do you sit alone as judge, while all these people stand around you from morning till evening?" Moses answered him, "Because the people come to me to seek God's will. Whenever they have a dispute, it is brought to me, and I decide between the parties and inform them of God's decrees and instructions." Moses' father-in-law replied, "What you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you will only wear yourselves out. The work is too heavy for you. You know, you cannot handle it alone. Listen now to me, and I will give you some advice, and may God be with you. You must be the people's representative before God and bring their disputes to him. Teach them his decrees and instructions, and show them the way that they're to live and how they are to behave. But select capable men from all the people, men who fear God, trustworthy men who hate dishonest gain, and appoint them as officials over thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. Have them serve as judges for the people at all times, but have them bring every difficult case for you, the simple cases that could decide themselves, that you will make your load lighter because they will share it with you. If you do this, and God so commands, you will be able to stand the strain, and all these people will go home satisfied." Moses listened to his father-in-law and did everything he said. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. Speak to God. Amen.
It's an amazing passage of scripture. After the sweeping epic stories of the exodus of thousands from Egypt, the miraculous parting of the Red Sea, the defeat of the Amalekites in a fierce battle, and then we have this beautiful account of a father-in-law meeting his son-in-law and talking and worshipping and working together. It's so simple, so kind of ordinary, And hopefully you'll agree, so inspiring. The film The Prince of Egypt depicts Jethro as a wonderful bear of a man who literally and emotionally embraces Moses and welcomes him into his family. You'll remember that Moses had stumbled into Jethro's life and family at his lowest point, when he was struggling to understand who he was and where he belonged, when he'd fled Egypt in disgrace and didn't know what he was going to do next. And Jethro had welcomed Moses with open arms. And maybe, as Ian's already described, we know people like that, people who embrace others and care for others in a very special way. This is my favourite picture of my dad. He was a very skilled motor mechanic who spent a lot of his later life working on vehicles for missionary organisations in Sudan and in Morocco. So it's appropriate that here he is with his head under the bonnet of a dilapidated minibus. I think he was in Gibraltar on his way from Morocco trying to limp it back to England. And he's got his passport in a little bag around his neck, it always was. But my dad always had time for people, for his children, his grandchildren, his sons-in-law, and his friends. Time to listen, time to help, time to care. And Jethro reminds me so much of my dad. So what made this meeting between Moses and his father-in-law so special? Well, it began with an honest conversation, which could only happen because there was genuine listening. Moses was reunited with Jethro after all the events of his time in Egypt, the hardships and oppression of Pharaoh, those God-sent awful plagues, the hardening of Pharaoh's heart, the traumatic events of the Passover, and then the terror and final victory of the Exodus. And even since then, Moses had faced hard times with his people moaning and struggling to adjust to their life of freedom. And Moses sat down in his tent with Jethro and told him everything. Everything the Lord had done, all the hardships they'd met, and how the Lord had saved them. And Jethro listened. He genuinely listened with care, concern, and understanding. And the second thing which made this meeting so special was their mutual faith and the opportunity to share worship together. Jethro was delighted to hear about all the good things that the Lord had done for Israel. Praise be to the Lord who rescued you. You can imagine them, can't you? Praying and worshipping together. And there's no greater privilege than to worship and pray with members of your family or with close friends. Now, I know I'm spoilt because one way or another, I get to do that with different members of my family at all sorts of times. But they're precious, precious times that need to be grabbed whenever we can. But after that initial time of sharing and worshipping together, Moses goes back to the day job of establishing and upholding a new society as his people learnt to live in freedom and community away from Egypt. And Jethro watched as Moses worked from morning till night, judging disputes and advising people. And then Jethro showed what I've called courageous concern. Moses was a young leader of a young nation, blessed and saved by God. And Jethro, with courageous concern, said to him, "What you're doing is not good." A brave man. "You and these people will only wear yourselves out. The work is too heavy for you." It takes a brave person to tell another leader that they're doing too much. But for Jethro, it came from a place of genuine concern and understanding and experience. Jethro was a leader of his own people. He'd welcomed Moses into his community and watched him grow and develop. Jethro knew what it was to lead and to shape a community. Jethro's concern came from a place of love, respect, knowledge, and experience. And it didn't come as an isolated negative comment. From his experience and understanding, Jethro offered Moses clear and practical solution for himself and his people. He suggested that Moses assign capable, well-trained helpers to take some of that burden. And Jethro didn't assume that his advice would just be taken. "I'll give you some advice," he said, "and may God be with you. If you do this and God commands, you will succeed." For Moses and Jethro, the ultimate authority and wisdom came from God. The plan and ministry were God's, and God would direct them. And any plans or advice given must have been weighed up with prayer and discernment on both sides. And then our passage ended with that wonderful verse. All you father-in-laws here. Moses listened to his father-in-law and did everything he said. But you can see where it came from. Moses knew Jethro. He'd seen him in his own ministry and community. He'd been welcomed into his family when he was at his lowest point. And so Moses listened with respect for Jethro's experience, with respect for his understanding and genuine concern, and with gratitude for his wisdom and practical insight. And ultimately, he listened because he recognized that they were both serving the same God. They were both seeking the same end, the service and worship of their saving and loving Father. It's an amazing passage, as relevant today as it's ever been. During our service, we're hearing about similar precious relationships that have shaped some of our church family members. Relationships built on just these things. And such relationships and conversations will be vital for all of us. There will be times when we are those who are overworked or overwhelmed, who need others to genuinely listen and care. There will be times when we need to be the ones who can and must give that time to genuinely listen and care. There will be times to give prayerfully considered, wise advice. And there will be times to accept advice with respect and gratitude. There will be times to show courageous concern and times to receive with love and care. But most of all our relationships need to be built on a shared trust and faith and confidence in our God who saves. They need to be relationships that involve a shared experience of prayer and worship and discerning God's will together. Those will be the life-changing, life-affirming relationships that you will remember forever.
Song.